into the topic straight away. Lean, carrier's prerogative. When we say lean, what is lean? Many of us may know and few of us may not know. Lean is the right of a person who has ability or a legitimate right to hold possession of a property for any of his unpaid dues that are legitimately due to him. General, lien is a right. As I told you, lien is a right actually, a legitimate right of an individual person to retain any property or goods which belongs to another person. He may not get the actual ownership over the cargo or a goods or a property just by exercising the lien, but still he becomes the custodian by exercising his right of lien. And until the demands of the person who is exercising the lien is satisfied or clear or settled, he has a right to hold the possession of the goods or the property which he is holding. The right of lien is granted by both law but also by contract. So in general, there are two types of lien. One is a customary lien, another one is a contractual lien. The customary lien is being given to a person. The right of customary lien is being given to a person by tradition, by old school of practice, which says that a person who is entitled to receive a remuneration for the services rendered to another person, wherein the person who availed the services is not paying the amount or settling the service fee or service charge, then the person who rendered the service becomes a legitimate party to hold or possess the right of the goods. So in common law countries, let's see how the lien is being recognized. The general lien and particular lien are two type of lien that is being followed across the globe, and we will see what are those. The general lien is the right of a person to retain any property or any goods which are in his possession belongs to another person until a promise or liability is discharged. Means, in case a person renders a service to another person and the person who availed the service does not pay, the person who renders the service has a right of general lien in hand in taking over possession of any other cargo, any other property, any other goods that is in possession belongs to person B, who actually avails the services of person A, the service provider. Particular lien confines the right of a person to a particular property against which the service has been rendered. For example, we will see two illustrations. For general lien, A renders the services of transportation to B for the cargo that is getting moved from one point to another point, and he takes delivery of the cargo. He did not pay the amount. In general lien, A has a right of exercising the right of lien against B's any other property provided it is under the possession of A. But in case of particular lien, a person who renders the service, for example, same illustration, person A can exercise his right of lien only against that particular person. That is the basic difference between general lien and particular lien. Who can actually practically be a person who has a right of lien? An unpaid seller, an agent or a principal, property for unpaid remuneration. Third one, a bailee on the property of bailor his possession. Let's see who is bailee. Indian Contract Act 1872, section 148 defines what is bailment. Bailment is the delivery of goods by one person to another for some purpose upon a contract that they shall, when the purpose is accomplished, be returned or otherwise disposed of according to the directions of the persons delivering to them. As per the Act, the person delivering the goods is called the bailor. A person whom they have delivered is called bailee. In simple, a person who is actual owner of the cargo, but for some reason he hand over the goods or property to some other person. The actual owner who has a title or ownership over the goods or the property will be the bailor. The person who holds the custody, temporary custody in any way, be it agent, be a service provider, who holds the cargo is bailee under Contract Act. process of bailment. How a bailment being executed? Transfer of possession of property by bailor to bailee for a purpose. We'll say, for example, a carrier or a ship owner or a shipping line takes the cargo for a transportation from one country to another country. So here, the carrier becomes the custodian, the responsible custodian of the cargo. He accepts the property for a purpose, which is carriage. Here, the purpose of the bailment is carriage. I'm just trying to relate the Indian Contract Act and the carriage here. And handing back the possession by the bailor to bailee after fulfilling the purpose, which means completion of carriage or the voyage, then the cargo is being handed over to, again, the actual cargo owner. Here, the relevancy of bailment here to the carrier is, he becomes the seller, buyer, the person who has the actual ownership of the cargo, hand over the cargo to the carrier for the purpose of carriage or the voyage. The process becomes bailment. In simple, actual owner, the custodian, bailor, bailee. This is a simple bailment process which can be related to a carriage. It also applies to all kinds of carriage, both sea carriage, road carriage, and air carriage, or multimodal transportation, whatever it be. This process of bailment, what is being defined in Indian Contract Act, applies to any type of carriage. Particular lien is also being defined in Indian Contract Act, where the bailee has a purpose of bailment. He renders any services involving the exercise, for example, labor, a skill services that is being rendered. In case there is no contract between the bailor or the bailee or the carrier or the cargo owner, in contradictory to the contract, the right to retain such goods is still with the person who rendered the service. Even though there is no contract available, there is no proper contract that is being executed between both two parties. Which means it very clearly establishes that the liability to pay the service provider by a service availer, it's not just a contractual liability, it is a customary liability. It also mandates by law under the section 170 of Indian Contract Act that a person who avails the service, by default, he has to pay the amount. There are certain cases. What happened if there is any deficiency of service? We will see that in future slides. Simple example for a particular lien. A delivers a rough diamond to B, a jeweler, to be cut and polished, which is accordingly done. B, who actually provided the service, is entitled to retain the goods, here the diamond, till he is paid for the services he has rendered. So you guys would have learned already under Contract Act, if not just you'll go through Contract Act, that what a bailment says, what is a particular lien that is being mentioned in the Indian Contract Act. It is a very simple illustration. How does it affect a carrier in an international carriage, in a sea carriage? How does it affect? How the process of bailment and lien that is being applied in the carriage? Let's see one by one. The general lien gives a right to the person who can exercise right of lien against any cargo, any goods, any property that are in his possession that belongs to another person who has liability to pay him. For example, bankers, factors, wharfingers, attorneys of high court and policy brokers, even though there is no contract. Even again, Indian Contract Act very clearly says, even there is no contract available in this regard, he has a right to hold the property, goods or cargo belongs to another person who has a liability to settle a service fee that is rendered. The important point here is the carrier has the right to exercise both general lien and particular lien against any unpaid due or any unmet obligation by a buyer or the seller or the service availer. But how does it differ? In which case a general lien will be applicable? In which case in particular lien will be applicable? In which are the countries or which are all the international governing rules or domestic rules that allows general lien and particular lien? Let's see one time. So, right of a lien to a carrier is well-established legal right available under law. As we see Indian Contract Act, we have gone through it so far, and Indian Contract Act says that, yes, you, in case you provide a service to a person, then you are entitled for a service fee. That is already there in Indian perspective. Civil law jurisdiction has very clearly said that the position of lien by a carrier is by default available under both local rules and international conventions. We will see what are they. Common law says the carrier, if you take one example, one governing law, for example, in common law jurisdiction, let us take India. There is the act called Multimodal Transportation of Goods Act 1993, MMTG Act. This MMTG Act says that a person is entitled to retain possession of goods until the freight is paid. Here, freight is the service charge or the transportation charge that is paid by a person for his transportation to the carrier. Here, in common law jurisdiction, under Carriage by Road Act or some other maybe MMTG Act, he is defined either as a multimodal transport operator or a common carrier. But it says they are entitled to retain possession of goods until the freight is paid, which means by default, the carrier is entitled to get his freight amount paid, irrespective of any situation, any counterclaim that is being raised against the carrier. Apart from the above, there are few international conventions and other foreign local domestic jurisdictions governing laws, such as Hague rules, Hague Visby rules, US COGSA is United States Carriage of Goods by Sea Act, and MMTG Act, Multimodal Transportation of Goods Act, or few governing rules for a contract of carriage, which provides right to carrier to exercise their right of lien. And of course, all the carriage, whether it is road, rail, sea, air, or multimodal, for each carriage, there will be a document called the bill of lading or airway bill or a consignment note based on their mode of transportation. So all these documents are construed as a contract of carriage. All these contracts of carriage will have its own terms and conditions. Of course, it will be pre-printed, legally approved, own terms and conditions of a carrier. But other than this mentioned governing rules, the specific contract of carriage also will have lien clause in it, which gives a carrier an absolute right to exercise his right of lien. And that is also allowed under law. Simple matter being that specific terms and conditions of contract of carriage is a specific performance contract which governs, which binds both the parties to the contract, which means both the carrier and the cargo owner has a legal binding to follow the terms and conditions mentioned in the contract of carriage. When a carrier assume and can he exercise, at what point he actually gets a right to exercise his lien? Just by receiving a cargo, just by receiving a goods in his possession, will he be able to exercise his right of lien? The right of lien is available to a carrier once the merchant, here merchant is defined as a person who is actual cargo owner, who wants his cargo to be transported from one person to one place to another place. Once the merchant hands over the possession of cargo to them from the purpose of carriage, which is established through contract of carriage. In this case, if the cargo is being handed over to carrier, and in turn, the carrier issues a contract of carriage or a bill of lading back to the merchant or the cargo owner, the right immediately passes to the carrier. Once the carrier issues a bill of lading, that is contract of carriage, they are entitled for right to lien, and same can be exercised by the carrier only when there are any unpaid charges or unmet obligation by the merchant. Here, the important thing is, in case the carrier is being paid in full of his actual service charges, freight charges, and transportation charges, he do not have any legitimate right to hold the cargo or any legal right to detain the cargo illegally, because carrier is only entitled for freight and his allied service fees, nothing beyond that. Which means once those things are getting paid by the actual merchant or the exporter or importer, the carrier does not have any right. But if it is not getting paid for whatsoever reason, the carrier invokes his right of lien, then exercises his right of lien, and he detains the cargo, keep the cargo in his possession until that is getting paid or settled. What can be the subject matter? A carrier has a right to excise lien or detain not only the cargo which he handed over from cargo for carriage, but also documents. For example, if the cargo is getting exported from India to USA. So when a cargo is getting exported, before export, there is a document has to be filed with the Indian customs for a declaration of cargo value specification saying that this is the cargo I am going to export from India to US, and this is the weight, which is the value, it is the HSN code, and this is the standards, this is the packing. All these things has to be declared to Indian customs, for which Indian customs will issue a document called shipping bill. The shipping bill is a document issued by a customs authority for export cargo. So when the carrier wants to exercise his right of lien, he cannot just hold the cargo. The subject matter, it's not just the cargo. He can also hold the shipping bill. I have just given an example of one document which can be held. Shipping bill is also a property which can be held back by the carrier so that the exporter cannot get benefits by submitting the shipping bill to bank or any other fiscal authorities. For a carriage from India to UAE, the illustration again says carrier has not received his freight, so he has the option of exercising his right over the cargo and detaining it. And he can hold the carriage documents, including the bill of lading. For example, bill of lading being a negotiable document and document of title, only if that document is given to the importer or the consignee destination, he will be able to take delivery of the cargo. Merely by holding the document at origin, that is the origin carrier, the load port carrier is holding the bill of lading in his hand, the destination importer or the buyer or the consignee is not able to take delivery of the cargo, which means merely by holding the bill of lading in his possession or in his custody, the carrier exercises his right of lien, whereas the cargo would have sailed and already reached the destination. But merely by holding the document, the delivery of the cargo is being stopped, which means just a document also can be used as a tool to exercise the right of lien, not just the cargo. And the governing rules, the important governing rule, if you take Multimodal Transportation of Goods Act 1993, Section 22 says that where under the Act, the carrier can exercise lien only over the particular cargo and document for which he have paid freight or other charges, not over other previous or future shipments of documents. We'll say there is a person, ABC company, who wants to export their cargo from India to Dubai, and they continuously gives business to XYZ carrier company. The carrier company continuously moves their cargo. There are maybe in a span of 1 month, there are 4 cargoes that is being moved from India to Dubai. So for first 3 shipments, the carrier has given delivery of the cargo at destination without collecting the freight charge, which means he is liable to collect the freight. But Multimodal Transportation of Goods Act says that he will not be able to exercise his right of lien on the lost cargo which is in hand, because if the ABC company, the cargo owner, come forward and said that I am going to pay the lost cargo and you should not exercise your right of lien, then you have to release the lost cargo in hand, because for the previous cargo you had a right to demand for lien before delivery. So once you have given it, then you will not be able to catch hold of on future shipments. But this is the position in Multimodal Transportation of Goods Act. In short, it can be defined as a particular lien. But what does United States Carriage of Goods by Sea Act say? What does Hague-Visby rule say? There is no a specific codified rule about whether a lien can be a particular or in general under these governing rules. But many of the judgments, many of the judgments given under these governing rules or these jurisdictions following territories have confirmed that they have given a wider view that the carrier can exercise his right of lien over any shipment or any document for any unpaid freight or charges under that particular contract of carriage or any other contracts. This is a settled position in under US COGS on Hague-Visby rules, whereas Indian Multimodal Transportation of Goods Act confines the carrier right of lien only towards a particular lien and not a general lien. Again, the same example. For example, first shipment is going from USA to Dubai. It is unpaid. Then the same person gives the cargo to UK to India. And he says that, no, I'll pay for the second UK shipment. I'll not pay for the first shipment. The carrier has the right to exercise a general lien, which has a wider scope and allows the carrier to recover his amount by holding the cargo in hand. He can recover his freight, which is payable for the previous carriages or previous contracts of carriages by the same merchant or the same buyer or the seller. So this is the settled position between Multimodal Transportation of Goods Act in India and United States Carriage of Goods by Sea Act and Hague-Visby Rules Convention. So I'll share some few case laws with you guys where if you take this case, it's a very classic case, Globe Transport Corporation versus National Insurance Company. The judgment says that can a carrier hold the cargo of delivery from the cargo is getting exported from one country to another country. The exporter or the seller has to pay the freight charges to the carrier. But he says that the shipper or the seller or exporter says that carrier, I am not going to pay you here. You can collect it from my buyer at the destination country or port of discharge. That whether you will be able to collect it, you collect it. So the carrier holds the cargo in custody, saying that it has to be paid by the buyer or the importer or the consignee. Just because it is the liability of the shipper, the consignee or the buyer will not be able to evade his liability or waive off his legal responsibility to pay the freight charge to the carrier. The carrier can claim a general lien for the goods in respect of the amount, no matter who has title over the cargo, who has the ownership over the cargo. But the person who has title over the cargo will also have a legal liability to pay the freight charges. Bill of lading being a negotiable and title document, merely by endorsing, by making an endorsement on the bill of lading, the importer or the buyer assumes the right and ownership over the cargo. He gets the title over the cargo, due to which he also carries a liability to pay the freight amount to the carrier. And this case very clearly clarified this position. It is still the settled position. It was upheld by Honorable Supreme Court of India also that the carrier can exercise his right of lien, be it a shipper or the consignee. Shipper means exporter, consignee means importer. So both the shipper or the consignee, it can be either party. They can do a blame game between themselves, but still the carrier has to be paid until which the cargo can be held or detained by the carrier. One interesting English judgment. This judgment is given by House of Lords. It's an English court judgment. It says there is a service deficiency. This case says about a service deficiency by the carrier. The carrier did not deliver the cargo properly. He did not deliver the cargo in good condition. He did not deliver it in nice condition. There is an adverse remarks. There is a shortage. There is a damage. There is a loss to the cargo sustained by the actual cargo imported. So the person who imported the cargo has raised a counterclaim against the carrier, saying that, no, see, mister, I have given so-and-so cargo, but it has not been delivered to me in intact same condition how it has been handed over to you at port of loading. So I am raising a counterclaim against you and I will not pay you the amount. This is the fact of the case. It is the vessel was let on a voyage charter. It was to go to Gulf, take petroleum and oil materials and go to European market. The bill of lading or the charter party used here is under Hague's rules. And while delivering the cargo, there is a shortage of oil or shortage of petroleum, due to which the person who is the charterer or the cargo owner has deducted $30,000 US dollar from the freight payable to the owners. Then they said that I'm not going to make this payment. And after 1 year, the carrier has filed a case against these guys, saying that my freight charges are legally liable to be paid at any cost. If there is any deficiency of service from my side, of course, I am in service industry, service failure might happen, but that has to be handled, dealt separately. The settled portion here is, in case there is a counterclaim that is raised against the carrier, the shipper or the consignee, that is the seller or the buyer, has to pay the freight in first instance. There will not be any counterclaim or set off that is available against the carrier for their any alleged claim for damage or loss. If there is any damage or loss, if there is any deficiency of service, that can be handled, that can be taken up in a separate forum, that can be contested in a separate way. There cannot be legally, this is a settled portion, there cannot be a counterclaim or a set off that is available against a carrier, which is very clearly established under this judgment, Aries Tanker Corporation versus Total Transport Limited. It is English court judgment. The cost incurred, actually, if there is any cost incurred on lien, if there is any cost incurred, the lien can be exercised, as I told you in the beginning, the lien can be exercised for the freight and other service charges that are payable, legally payable to the carrier. Here, what are all the other legal charges? What are the legitimate charges that could a carrier that the carrier is entitled to? If the cargo is sailing in a container, that in destination, there is a delay by the importer in taking delivery of the container. And there is a charge that is being levied by the carrier for detaining the container beyond the agreed days, which means it is called detention and demurrage. Detention is a charge levied by the carrier for detaining the container beyond the agreed time limit. Demurrage is the ground charges for holding the container in a particular land or a particular warehouse or CFS or godown. So this detention and demurrage charges are also a part of freight. No matter it is because of whose liability, because of whose delay, because of whose deficiency in service, such delay has happened and such detention and demurrage or storage penalty has incurred, who has to absorb this cost? In this case, Monica India versus Union of India, it is very clearly established that the merchant, again, I'm saying the merchant includes either the exporter or the importer, that is the seller of the cargo or the buyer of the cargo, is responsible for the demurrage or detention that are incurred or levied by the customs authorities or shipping lines or any party. Even for this particular cost, the carrier is entitled to exercise his right of lien against the cargo that is in his custody. With this, I conclude my presentation and let's discuss any questions you have. Thank you so much.